Welcome, and thank you for finding your way here to our online worship service at Fairbanks First United Methodist Church. I'm Caroline. I'm the praise band leader here, and we just want you to know that we're happy you could join us today for the service. You're going to hear some scripture and prayers and praise music and traditional music, and it's all sung and spoken to God's glory. Thanks for being here, and enjoy the service.
Please join us in singing All the People Said, Amen.
You are not alone if you are lonely when you feel afraid. You're not the only, we are all the same. In need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you've got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For this is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people shout amen.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us here at First United Methodist Church in Fairbanks, Alaska. Today is August 11th, 2024. It's the 12th Sunday after Pentecost. And today, along with today being the last day of the Olympics in Paris, we're going to take a look at the discipleship of the Olympics of discipleship and how to practice those things of discipleship so that we can be Olympic champions in faith.
Thank you.
us join together in the opening prayer. Wondrous and gracious God, we're waiting and hoping. We're waiting to hear your call new and fresh. We're waiting for assurance and peace. We're waiting to know and experience your love anew. We are your people, called by you to live and to serve and to love. Fill us anew with strength and courage from your great Spirit. In the name of our risen Lord. Amen. Listen now for a word from the Lord as I read from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25 through chapter 5, verse 2. Paul writes, "So then, putting away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with your neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Those who steal must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor, doing good work with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is good for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people.
My word to them, whom shall I?
August 11th, 2024. Probably as you're watching this, or, yep, the Olympic closing ceremonies in Paris may already be underway. And you've probably already heard some of the stories of champions being made, of what people overcame in order to just merely compete, let alone win a medal. Yes, we had some examples of folks who overcame, like Leyla Gul of Azerbaijan. She competed while 6 months pregnant. So did Nada Hafez of Egypt, a fencer, 7 months pregnant. And then there was others who, by Olympic athlete standards, were probably seniors as they competed this past couple weeks, like Yusuf Diki, a Turkish shooter, 51 years old, which is old by Olympic standards. They said that he was not into using all kinds of strange equipment. He just wore earplugs, and he actually was able to shoot best with both eyes open. And then there's Xingyi Zheng, a Chilean table tennis player who was originally from China, who played table tennis at the Olympics at the age of 58. One thing's for sure, all of them probably put in hours and hours and hours of practice, and years and years and years of practice. Brian McLaren, a leader in the emerging church movement, tells of hearing that books on Buddhism were much more popular and selling faster than books on Christianity. The answer to why this might be the case is he thought Buddhism represents itself as a way of life, whereas Christianity represents itself merely as a system of belief. So it might be time to rediscover our faith as a way of life. It might be what people are searching today. The issue, of course, isn't either or, but both and. It's hard to deny too many of us may have lost the way of our faith without a coherent, compelling way of life formed in community and expressed in mission. Some of us began losing interest in our system of belief, or worse, began to hold it grimly, even meanly, driving more and more people away from our faith rather than attracting them to it. Successful people, whether athletes or musicians, are the product of two factors coming together, both potential and practice. So, where do faithful disciples come from? Are they born or are they made? The truth is, they're both. They are the result of an intersection of timing and talent and influences, and also with a product of tenacity. They're a product of a community of people who help them along the way. No one truly makes it on their own, and they can't practice on their own either. We don't do our faith alone. In Ephesians, the Apostle Paul offers essentially the same thesis. If we're going to be Olympian Christians, the potential for that success is found in a community of faith where we're teaching and practice alongside wise and faithful mentors, nurtures people into maturity. Yes, Paul reminds us that the Ephesians, that they thought that they had learned the truth from Jesus himself, yet that truth results in putting away the life that they had known previously. As they close yourselves, as Paul puts it, with a new created according to the likeness of God and to righteousness and holiness. The community of faith, in other words, provides the support, the spiritual parentage that helps shape people into the likeness of God. We cannot be Olympians of faith on our own. It takes community. Yes, even as Christians need to practice at being Christians the way athletes practice. But here's the thing, all the training and nurturing in the world can't make us successful as disciples if we don't practice what we've learned and embody what we've been taught. It could be argued that without that, what we have is just an empty shell that people can see right through. Yes, you've probably heard before that many great musicians took at least 10,000 hours to get where they were. Supposedly, the Beatles never really found success until they really put their nose to the grindstone and put in 10,000 hours worth of practice. And of course, there's Mozart, who took 20 years of composing before he produced his greatest work. Specifically, what we need to do is practice of the faith is something that we don't talk much about. But your parents and your grandparents knew how important it was. As a matter of fact, I know some of you grew up in families where your parents or grandparents would pull you by the ear and take you kicking and screaming to worship. Well, what happens in worship? Well, it starts with the readings and the listening to the word, the creeds of confession, the words of the songs themselves, the deliberate practice of shalom, even such things as the passing of the peace. The disciples of Jesus followed him around for 3 years. And if you do the math, that comes out to more than 10,000 hours. Yes. And also consider also that Jesus himself took 30 years before he even entered public ministry. Yes, Paul says that disciples should practice many things. Now, you probably remember hearing it said that it's not just practice that makes perfect, but perfect practice makes perfect. Paul would probably first say disciples should practice telling the truth to one another. Truth-telling sometimes is a glue that helps to bind community, to build community. Falsehood, lying, on the other hand, creates a cloud of suspicion and secrecy. Practice telling people the truth in love. And after maybe 10,000 hours of doing it, you'll be better at it. Coupled with truth-telling is also dealing honestly with things, like dealing honestly with anger. Secrets, lies, and rumors lead to false assumptions and then can produce anger. Practice the principle of dealing with your anger quickly and thoroughly before the sun goes down, Paul writes. Yes, it gives you the greater sense of self-control, enables forgiveness of others quicker. It leads to the restoration of community. Yes, work for 10,000 hours on an intentional program of forgiving. We also need to practice our speech as well. Our forebears of the Second World War that got us through that knew the cost of loose lips. Literally, they would say, loose lips sink ships. It's the same. Loose and evil talk has become the norm sometimes, even for those that claim to follow Jesus. Just witness, for example, the kind of vitriol going around about current political races. Yes, successful disciples, however, engage in the daily practice of discipling our speech to reflect the speech that builds up others rather than tearing them down. Yes, Paul also writes about grieving the Holy Spirit. It seems to be another way of saying that when you violate your baptism or your role that you've been called to and set aside for in building up community, if your baptism is the mark of the Holy Spirit, then you need to reflect that daily in your conduct and in your speech, in your thought life, to reflect the Spirit's presence. We can't merely settle for the privilege of grace when we receive baptism. We have to practice it. We have to demonstrate it every day in being graceful to others. And our lives begin to mirror the character of God. In verse 31 and 32, Paul sums up the argument by saying that if we're practicing Christians, then things like bitterness and wrath and anger and arguments and slander and malice will eventually be put away and replaced with kindness and tenderheartedness and forgiveness. And that will only happen through the discipline of practice, through practice, beginning with worship, where we remember who we are and who we've called to be and to whom we belong. Even when great challenges come that may test our patience, by remembering who we are, we can succeed in revealing Christ even in times of stress. Yes, failure may still come, as Paul writes in Corinthians when he speaks of sin being like a wolf at the door, but it's less likely. The true gauge of success, according to Paul, is there when their character begins to mirror God in the way that a child mirrors their parents. The ultimate example, again, Jesus spending 30 years getting ready for his public ministry, which sadly only lasted for 3 years, but was so perfect, it changed the world. If we're going to be successfully following him, we need to invest in things, a couple things. First of all, living in a community of faith and taking the time to practice those things that he mirrored from God, to practice, and of course, to not be messy about it, but it's not just practice, but perfect practice that makes perfect. And then maybe one day we'll be ready to be Olympian disciples. We thank you for your support, for your gifts of time and treasure and effort and energy. And now, gracious God, you've blessed us abundantly. And so we always seek to give back. We offer what we bring to you and to your kingdom. Help us always to give generously from what we have, for we know that you are filled with joy when we give fully from our hearts. Thank you for blessing us so richly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join us in admitting that this is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? The whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let us take our joys as well as our concerns unto the Lord in prayer. Secure our steps, O God, on rough terrain and on shifting sands, on narrow paths. Secure our steps in the boardroom, at the water cooler, at the checkout line. Secure our steps, whether chasing after deadlines or trailing after toddlers, scrambling towards finish lines. Make our steps secure, pacing through hospitals, wandering through hurt, tripping over the unforeseen, meandering our way through grief. Keep us firm in the Lord as we come to you with the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, wherever you are, whenever you're watching, may God's faithfulness and kindness never fail. May our lives be changed as the gospel is lived out in our words and in our actions. Go now full of kindness and mercy for others. Amen.
Jesus conquered the grave. My Savior, He can move.